In this video tutorial, I am going to discuss about sphingolipids. Now, in the previous video, we were discussing about the glycerophospholipids. Glycerophospholipids. Now, in case of glycerophospholipids, the central alcohol molecule was the glycerol, okay, which is the 3-carbon compound having the 3 OH groups, right? So, actually, because of this glycerol molecule, that compound, that whole group of compound, it was known as glycerophospholipids. In case of sphingolipid, the central alcohol molecule is the sphingol. It is the sphingol, which is also known as, sphingosine. This is the name of alcohol, name of actually a central alcohol in this complete group of compounds. So, let's first understand what is the structure of sphingol, then only we can discuss about the sphingolipids, okay. So, this sphingol is basically 18 carbon long compound, it is 18 carbon long compound. So, let's first mention the all 18 carbons. So, this is first carbon, then second carbon, then third carbon, then fourth carbon, then fifth carbon. Between this fourth and fifth carbon, there are double bonds, okay. So, fifth carbon, then the sixth carbon, and this structure is repeated somewhat 12 times, okay. So, that makes total 17 carbon, and this is 18th carbon. On the first carbon, there is OH group is there. On the second carbon, amide group is there. Third carbon also contain OH group, and rest of the carbon, they simply contain a hydrogen. So, let's fill up the hydrogen positions. Here one hydrogen, here two hydrogen, here CH, and here CH2. So, CH2 is 12 times, and here CH3. So, you can compare this structure of this sphingol with the glycerol. See, in case of glycerol, in case of this sphingol, what is happening? It is containing these 3 carbons, which look similar to these 3 carbons of the glycerol, okay. On the first carbon, there is OH. Here, all 3 carbon contain OH, whereas here first carbon and third carbon contain OH, whereas middle carbon contain amide group, okay. So, when we wanted to show this glycerol schematically, we were using this vertical bar, right? Vertical bar was used, and this 3 OH group, as this all 3 OH groups are important, we are showing it like this. Whereas, in case of this sphingol, we can represent this sphingol schematically by such inverted L, right? So, this complete carbon chain can be represented by this inverted L, and we can show this active group, okay? Now, here one interesting thing is that this OH group on the first carbon and this amide group on the second carbon, these are only biologically important. This OH group is actually not important. It is not participating in any important biochemical reaction, okay. So, finally, whenever required, we will draw the structure of sphingosine by this inverted L, okay, by this inverted L in box-like manner. And this OH group on the first carbon and amide group on the second carbon will be shown like this. This OH group will not be shown in this schematic structure, okay. Why? Because it is less important, or it is not at all important in our biochemical reaction. That's why. So, this is a sphingol. This is a sphingol. So, now whenever we require to mention a sphingol, we will simply draw this diagram, okay. So, once we understand what is sphingol, we have to understand that this sphingol, it binds with fatty acid. Sphingol binds with fatty acid. That compound formed, it is known as ceramide. So, now what is ceramide? We need to draw a structure of ceramide, okay. So, to understand that, we all know that fatty acid, on one end, it is C double H group. Then it has very long carbon chain, it may be 16, 18, 20, 22 carbons are there, and then there is a CH3 group, okay. In sphingol, we have two active groups, one is amide and another is OH group. So this fatty acid, it basically binds with this amide group. So let's see how it will bind. So first, so to draw a structure of ceramide, first I am drawing this sphingol. So this is a schematic structure of sphingol in the inverted L. Now when this NH2 binds with this C double OH group, what will happen? This out of this two hydrogen, one hydrogen is removed. So it looks like this, and which is bound with only single hydrogen. One hydrogen is removed and that hydrogen binds with this OH. So what will happen? H2O, that H and this OH, it is removed as a H2O. So now there is a C double bond O only. So here the remaining thing is C double bonded with O, and then the complete fatty acid chain is arranged like this. So there is a formation of bond. There is a formation of bond between this nitrogen and carbon. So such bond is formed. Okay. So this bond is known as amide linkage. It is known as amide linkage. And on the first carbon, OH is there. So this compound, it is known as ceramide. We have to remember that the bond between fatty acid and sphingol is not of the ester, but it is of the amide linkage. Why? Because the amide group is participating in this reaction. Okay. So now this ceramide is very important compound. Why? Because this ceramide in all the sphingolipids, this ceramide is always found. It is always found. Okay. So now you can see that in any compound, if you find this structure, if you find such structure, you can immediately come to know that yes, this structure or this compound is from this sphingolipid group. Now this sphingolipid group, it is classified. Now you see all these things are fixed. Only at the one position there is a variation is possible. What is that position? That position is this carbon number 1. At this carbon number 1, this OH group is reactive. Now this carbon number 2, this NH and C, this NH2 group is already satisfied. So now it is not active. Why? Because it is bound with the fatty acid. Now only this one group is possible. So now here something, this OH binds with some polar group, okay. So based on the nature of the polar group, these sphingolipids are divided mainly into two part. So based on what they are divided into two part? Based on the polar group, based on the nature of polar group. So basically only two types of polar group can be there. One is phosphate containing polar group, and the second group is carbohydrate containing polar group. Okay, only two polar groups are there. It can be either phosphate containing polar group or carbohydrate containing polar group. If phosphate containing polar groups are there, they are known as phosphosphingolipids. And what is the example of this phosphosphingolipids? The example of phosphosphingolipid is the sphingomyelin. So in case of sphingomyelin, the polar group most of the time it is a phosphate bound with choline, or sometime it is phosphate bound with ethanolamine. Okay. So now what about the carbohydrate containing polar group? If carbohydrate is there as a polar group, that group of compound, it is known as glycosphingolipids. glycosphingolipids. Why this word glyco? Because glyco means carbohydrate. So now these glycosphingolipids, they are basically divided into three parts. Based on the nature of carbohydrate, they are divided into three parts. So three parts based on what? Based on nature of carbohydrate, based on nature of carbohydrate. So if only single sugar is there, if only single sugar compound is there, single sugar as polar group, as a polar group is there, then that compound is known as cerebroside. Cerebrosides. Now, as a single sugar, that means it may be a glucose or it may be a galactose. So, for example, if glucose is there as a polar group, we call it as a glucocerebrosides. Glucocerebrosides. If galactose is there as a polar group, we call it as a galactocerebroside. Galactocerebrosides. Now, the second type of sugar, second nature of sugar, if two or more sugars are there as a polar group on the first carbon of the sphingol, we call it as a globoside. See, remember, if only one sugar molecule is there, we call it as a cerebroside. If two or more sugars are there as a polar group, we call it as a globosides. Now, here the third case is little bit unique. If N-acetyl neuraminic acid is there as a component of polar group, that means it may contain a single sugar or double sugar, but in addition to that, if there is N-acetyl neuraminic acid is there, then we forget about cerebroside and globoside. We immediately give it a name of gangliosides. So this N-acetyl neuraminic acid, in the short form, it is known as NaNA. Okay. So suppose in some sphingolipid, if there is a glucose is there, then there is an NaNA is there, and then there is a galactose. What we call it as a? We call it as a ganglioside. Okay. Why not globoside? Because it contains a NaNA. At that time, we don't have to apply this rule that, okay, it has two or more sugar, so we should call it as a globoside. No, this is the superior rule. If NaNA is there in the structure, immediately you should call that compound as a ganglioside. So this completes the classification of sphingolipids. So the highlighting, the main points are that sphingolipids, so based on the nature of polar group, they are divided into two parts. If phosphate is there, it is known as phosphosphingolipids, and example is sphingomyelin, right? If carbohydrates are there, we call it as a glycosphingolipids, and then based on the nature of carbohydrate, if only single sugar is there as a polar group, we call it as a cerebroside. If two or more sugars are there as a polar group, we call it as a globosides. And if N-acetyl neuraminic acid occurs as a polar group, we call it as a gangliosides. So this compounds, this sphingomyelin, then this cerebrosides, then this globosides, and this gangliosides. These are very, very important compound. In the next few videos, in next 2 to 3 video, I will discuss about this sphingomyelin, cerebroside, globosides, and gangliosides in full detail. So if you have any query or confusion, please write it down in the comment section below. Please like, share, and subscribe to my channel. Thank you.